coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch has become tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midday, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. The word of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Happy New Year. Thank you. I know that seems strange to say, but Advent is the beginning of our church year, one of the ways where we're a little out of step with the world at large. We're singing, O Come, Emmanuel, when everyone else is singing Frosty the Snowman. We're talking about silence and waiting and patience when the world is looking at joy. And this year in particular, I feel like Advent has something very important to teach us and to give us as we live in this very weird time. Advent is a strange season in many ways. It's strange because every other season of the year is about something that's already happened. Christmas is about the birth of Jesus, Epiphany about the revealing of Jesus, Lent about the trials of Jesus, Holy Week about the passion of Jesus, Easter about the resurrection of Jesus, Ascension about his ascending to heaven, Pentecost about the coming of the Holy Spirit, and then there's Advent, which is about something in the future, something that hasn't happened yet, something that we look forward to, the coming of the reign of God in all of its glory. It's a little scary in our readings. We hear about, you know, God tearing open the heavens and coming down. There's talk about the day of the Lord, which in the Old Testament was kind of ominous because it involved judgment for those who had been unrighteous. It's a little scary, but it's also hopeful. It's about living in darkness when we can see the light just over the horizon, anticipating the time when God's kingdom, God's reign will be established on earth as it is in heaven. Should ring a bell, on earth as it is in heaven. We pray that prayer a lot, and it is our deepest longing that God will establish God's reign on earth and bring about this time of peace and justice, this end of all the suffering and strife and difficulty. Advent speaks to me this year particularly because of the situation in which we find ourselves vis-a-vis the pandemic. You know, there's been a lot of fantastic news lately, news about vaccines that have astonishing positive results in the early testing. It looks like vaccine will be able to be shipped next month in just a couple of weeks for a disease that was first discovered 1 year ago. Friends, this has never happened before, that we identified a new disease and within 1 year were able to actually distribute a vaccine. This is like the moonshot for epidemiologists. This is an amazing accomplishment and something to rejoice in, to be thankful for, and to anticipate with great, wonderful joy. However, we are still living with the pandemic. In fact, we're seeing rates skyrocketing, an uncontrolled spread of this disease, which is causing us once again to restrict our movements, to go into lockdowns, to reduce the kinds of things that we so much long to do. And it's been a long year. In a way, you know, if Advent is a time of waiting, 2020 has been a whole year of Advent, a whole year of just trying to have patience. And the themes of Advent, therefore, are so critically important for us as Christians because they are the precise qualities that we need to get through this time. Practicing Advent spirituality is actually the very best thing that we can do in this time when we're living in a present darkness but anticipating a time of light. And those qualities are patience and endurance and hope and faith, the kind of resiliency that is required for those who are followers of Jesus, living in a world of sin and looking for the coming of Christ to bring about that peace and justice and joy and the consummation of God's ultimate plan. When I think about this journey of Advent, when I think about this weird in-betweenness of Advent, living in one reality but looking towards another, when I think about our life in the pandemic, living with these restrictions and worries and anxiety and sickness and death, to be quite honest, but looking for the vaccine and a return to not, I really believe, not the old way, but something new, something different, something that is full of hope, a world that might actually, hopefully, you know, if ever human beings can learn something, I hope we can learn from this time and to apply those lessons to this future. When I was thinking about all this, I thought about a particular person. You know, we've got great characters in Advent. We've got John the Baptist. We'll be hearing from him next Sunday and the Sunday after. We've got the prophet Isaiah. We've got all the prophets who are preaching about the coming of God's reign and God's day and the day of the Lord. But there's another person that really leapt out at me this week as a great example of how to live an Advent life. And that person, of course, I mean, you're all thinking the same name, I'm sure, is Dolly Parton. You weren't thinking of Dolly Parton? You remember Dolly Parton. When I was a kid, she was kind of a punchline, to be honest, right? She was kind of a caricature, a sort of larger-than-life, sorry about the pun, person who was just hilarious. But the more I've gotten to know about Dolly Parton, especially lately, the more respect I have for her, the more admiration, and the more I think she offers us an example of a way to live an Advent life. You know, Dolly Parton grew up dirt poor. It's a familiar story, like so many people, big family, no money, no hope, no options. And yet, through her determination and grit, she was able to break out of that life. She built herself, you know, working from the ground up, a career in Nashville, ultimately becoming a big country western star. But she didn't stop there, right? That would have been enough for a lot of people. She kept going. She got a TV show. She was in movies. She even built her own theme park. Think about that. How many people build their own theme park? But she didn't stop there either. She built this amazing empire, made herself buckets of money. But she never forgot where she came from. her little county in West Tennessee, she created a program for kids because so many people struggled to learn how to read and write. Her own dad had never learned to read, and so she started to give away books. She started this imagination library, and eventually it grew and grew and grew. It's national, and now it's international. To date, I just read her, and it's not just her now, it's a huge organization, they have given away almost 150 million books to kids in this country and several others. That's amazing. But she didn't stop there. Last April, and I missed this whole story, but last April, she gave $1 million for research into the COVID-19 vaccine. She worked with Vanderbilt University. She had a friend there who was a doctor that she wanted to honor. She gave this money. They were partnering with Moderna, which was the smallest of the biotech companies that was working on the virus. Very small kind of startup company. And Moderna, this little company, partnering with Vanderbilt and other universities, was one of the first to come up with a vaccine that looks like it will be 95% effective. Dolly Parton, who lived through unimaginable suffering and difficulties in her early life, I'm sure has had many struggles in her later life, somehow was able to look ahead and to see possibilities where there were only problems, to see the problem of illiteracy in rural counties in Tennessee, and to find a way to do something. She couldn't solve illiteracy, but she could give away some books. When the COVID-19 disease came, she looked at that and said, what can I do? I've got resources. How could I help? And she took some of her resources and she put them to work for the well-being of all of us. I want to suggest that that is a way that we can live into the Advent season. We are called upon at this time to have endurance, patience, to wait. But waiting is not just a passive activity. Waiting is not just sitting around and doing nothing. Although, you know, I like watching Netflix. I don't consider that nothing. I've seen some really great stuff. But there's more to it. Active waiting as an Advent people of hope, looking for the coming of the reign of God, means doing what we can, even if it seems so tiny. Where we can, as much as we can. It's efforts like continuing to support Neighborhood House and Bound Together and the other outreach organizations that we work with and support. It means donating blood through the Red Cross. It means giving food for the food baskets. It means finding ways to share our good news with those who are around us. Right? Those who are lonely. Right now, loneliness is a crippling problem. It's been a crippling problem for those who are elderly before the pandemic, but now it's a crippling problem for even more. What can we do to reach out in love to those around us? A neighbor in our neighborhood, a member of our congregation, someone in our family, to pick up the phone, to teach someone how to use Zoom, to find a way to send a personal note. I've gotten some personal notes during the pandemic from parishioners. And I want to say how much those have meant to me. Just a little sign of incarnational love. A little piece of paper with some writing on it that turns loneliness into relationship, that reminds us that we are connected, part of something bigger, part of this community that God is creating continually through the gift of the Holy Spirit. We may be physically separated, but we are united through bonds of love in the Holy Spirit, united in our patient endurance and waiting as people of hope. So I hope you'll take a page from Dolly Parton's notebook. I hope you'll look and participate as you can in this Advent season to turn away from the voices of negativity and despair and anger and blaming. You know, all of that negative energy that can get so implanted in our hearts. To take this opportunity to put that to the side and to look over the horizon at the light that is coming, the light of Christ, the light of God's reign, the light of peace and justice and hope and love, the light of God's eternal and abiding love promised to us this Advent and at Christmas and to the ages of ages. Amen. I invite you now to join in the Advent Creed. We believe in God, robed in splendor, veiled in mystery, ruler alike of darkness and light. We encounter God in Jesus Christ, who is tested and put to death, but whose radiance could not be quenched, whose touch brings a blaze of color to a dull, drab world, reviving the weary, healing the wounded, unsettling the satisfied. We walk with God, guided by the light of God's loving Spirit, the light which enters the shadowed places of our hearts and leads us into truth and life. We wait for God and for the fulfillment of God's promises, for the time when the darkness will hold no fear and the light will show the way, and creation will be made whole once more, and God's peace will reign forever. Amen.